presentation, video presentation on memory organization of microcontroller 16F877a. Myself, Mr. Vipul Kondekar. The learning outcomes of this video session are, at the end, student will be able to differentiate between Harvard architecture and von Neumann architecture for microcontrollers, and then you'll be able to identify, describe the program memory organization as well how stack operates for the PIC microcontroller. And third outcome will be, student will be able to describe the data memory organization for the PIC microcontroller. These are the contents in this presentation. Harvard von Neumann architecture we will see, then we will go for understanding how program memory is organized, how stack operates, and then at the end how data memory is organized for the PIC microcontroller. Now let us try to understand what these two architectures are, Harvard and von Neumann. So if you look at this block diagram here, you'll find that in this image you got CPU and memory, and that memory has program as well as data present. So program data is available in the memory itself, and it is interfaced to the CPU through single bus. And then if you look at Harvard architecture, you find that CPU is there, but the memory, which is separated into two parts, one is called as program memory, another is called as data memory. And then two separate bus connectivity is available between CPU to the program memory and CPU to the data memory. So now what you can achieve with this architecture called as Harvard architecture is, you can have parallelism, you can have pipelining of the instructions, where you can have overlapping between the fetch and execution cycles. And that is possible in this Harvard architecture, where it expects that you should have a separate program memory and data memory. So you know the block diagram of PIC microcontroller, they will find that program memory and data memory is separate. So the architecture used for the PIC microcontroller is Harvard architecture. And hence, let us try to understand how program memory is organized for the PIC microcontroller. You recall how much program memory we have got for the PIC microcontroller. In the features, we say it is 8 kilobytes, 8K into 14 is the program memory available. Now, how you can access that program memory? So basically, there is one register called as program counter register. So that program counter register is a 13-bit wide register. 13 bits are sufficient to address 8K locations. So this PC can be used to access any of the location available in the program memory. So program memory addresses are starting from 0000H up to 1FFFH. So these addresses are again divided into four pages, page 0, page 1, page 2, and page 3. So paging is done here, and then you find that some addresses are very specific addresses, like address 0000. So this is what? This is a reset vector address. Whenever you apply some reset signal to the microcontroller, so the instruction which gets executed, which is stored at this particular address. As well, you have got one special address location called as 0004H. What you got here is an interrupt vector. As we know, there are many interrupts. Around 14 different interrupts are there for the PIC microcontroller. And you find that all these interrupts are vectored interrupts. Whenever interrupt occurs, the program execution sequence changes to this particular address, 0004. It will be very interesting to know, if all interrupts are occurring and interrupt vector address is same, then how microcontroller will understand which is the cause of that particular interrupt. Now, talking about the additional facility in the microcontroller along with the program memory and data memory is stack. So you have got 8 level stack available inside the PIC microcontroller. It is not part of program memory, neither program memory nor data memory. It is a separate hardware stack available. And then you have got 4 pages, each page is of 2K, so 8K memory is there. Now look at how stack operates. So you said 8 level stack is available. See, stack operates Stack basically is used for what? Whenever you are executing some call instruction or some interrupt occurs after execution of interrupt service routine or any subroutine, you want to come back to the main program. So how it is possible? You can come back to the main program if and only if the PC contents are stored somewhere. So we use stack for storing the contents of the PC. So when call gets executed or at the end of subroutine when you write a return, so this stack is used. Now, one important thing, only 8 stack locations are there inside the PIC microcontroller. So if you can push for 8 times only, if you try to push 9, means if you try to have 9 successive calls, what it does is that 9 push overrides the value that was stored from the first push. So if you are going just writing call instructions and they are storing the contents of PC, so 8 pushes are possible. But if you go for 9, so then that first push address will be overloaded by this push 9. So you cannot come back to the main program in this particular case. This you have to remember. So it's like cyclic buffer. Stack basically, this for PIC microcontroller acts like cyclic buffer. So as such, there is no status bit which will inform you that stack is overflow. So you have to make sure that the stack overflow is not occurring because of your program. As well, there are no instructions like push and pop. So you cannot access stack from any instruction. Only that call and return instruction, as well that return from interrupt. So these are the instructions which can only result into usage of stack, either for storing some data onto the stack memory or retrieving the data from the stack memory. Basically, it will be an address and that will be contents of PC. Now, let us try to understand how data memory is organized. As it is a hardware architecture, program memory and data memory is separate. So, data memory for the PIC microcontroller is organized into 4 different banks. Bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, bank 3. Now, how we can have selection of bank? So there are 2 bits available in one special function register called as status register, RP0 and RP1. These 2 bits are used for selection of the bank. So data memory is available in 4 different banks, and then the bank selection can be done by using the status register. Each bank is of 128 bytes. You'll find each bank is of 128 bytes. One important thing is all implemented bank contains special function registers as well general purpose registers. But you will find that some frequently use special function registers from one bank may be mirrored. So you will come to know with the next slide what is happening here. So this is again data memory organization. So it is organized into 4 different banks. But if you look at this organization, you will find that, let us look at this status register. You'll find that status register is available in all these banks. So why they are done like this? So it will avoid the time for changing the bank, because if you are in bank 1 and if you want to access status register and if it is not available in the bank 1, then you have to write code so that you will go back to the bank 0. Then you have to access that status register to change the bank select. So repeatedly use registers are mirrored into almost all banks, so that if whatever bank you are working in, you can use that register directly. Now again, in this particular data memory organization, you'll find it is divided into 2 parts. One is called as general purpose and another is called as special purpose RAM. General purpose RAM and general purpose registers and special purpose register. And if you look at just this general purpose register, in bank 0 you have got 96 bytes, then in bank 1 you have got 80 bytes, again in bank 2 you have got 80 bytes, and again here you have got these 80 bytes plus 16, 80 plus 16. So this 96 plus 80 plus 16 plus 80 plus 80 plus 16, that will result into 368. So this is what you say, data memory available as a general purpose register is 368 bytes. So that's why in future we say 368 bytes of RAM is there. But along with this general purpose register, you have got some special purpose registers also. Now this, as your general purpose and special purpose registers are the 2 parts of the data memory, here we will find that that general purpose registers are directly either directly you can access or indirectly by using the two addressing modes available, direct and indirect. And indirect addressing will be done through the register called as FSR register. Now talking about the special function registers, as we know that there are so many modules available, so those modules require some registers to control, and then for that you will be requiring special function register. These special function registers are again divided into two parts. One will be called as the special function registers which are related to the core operations like status register, and the special function registers which are related to the peripheral, like ADC is one peripheral available. So there is one register, special function register called as ADCON 0 or ADCON 1. So these are the special function registers which are related to the peripheral features. Now this is just overview of how you can have different special function registers. So these are the different special function registers. These are the addresses possible for few special function register. More than one addresses you are finding because it is available in more than one bank. And in that case, again, you'll find what is the significance of each and every bit of a particular special function register. So this is just a summary of few of the special function registers available inside the PIC microcontroller. These are the different references used for this particular presentation. Thank you.